Welcome in. It's the Positively Pet Land Show, AM 800 KXIC, Iowa City. It's our weekly pet show. Always having fun. Look at that face. It's a bulldog. We have two English bulldogs here in studio. And you want to take that puppy home, don't you? Just look at those eyes. It's adorable. They have these, their rolls, their fat rolls, and they are just adorable. But they're not right for everybody. If you're a marathon runner and you want to take your dog out for a run, not exactly the right dog for you. They will roll over at about an eighth of a mile and they will just lay there and you're not going to be able to take them with you. So we do want to explain what who this dog is right for. Certainly loved by many. There's a whole group of people out there that are very serious and they know everything about the different types of bulldogs. And we'll talk about what the bulldog's all about. We bring in Ron Salisbury from Petland of Iowa City. Ron, how are you?
Doing really good.
Thanks for bringing these two cuties in. And
hunk of chunks.
Yeah, right? They're hunk of chunks. And they made a big mess at your house, from what I understand.
Huh? This morning was above average as far as cleanup goes.
Half the food went in their mouth and half of it on the floor.
On the floor. I was sweeping, vacuuming, wiping up with cloths. I mean, I was, don't get a bulldog thinking that this is, I'm looking for that easy dog.
A nice, tidy dog.
I am like all about the energy level is low. I mean, they have this energy, but then they lose it really quickly because they just so massive that they wear themselves out real quick. But holy cow, they can poop and pee and eat and make it all over the place.
Snort.
Yeah.
And this one's about to fall asleep. They do love to sleep too.
There's nothing dainty about an English bulldog.
Absolutely not. And that's why you got to call it like Daisy or something like that.
Right? I love it.
So we're going to talk about the bulldog. We're also going to talk about if you have a problem, and I see this a lot too, especially now that the weather's turning, I see people struggling with their dogs as they walk down the street. And you know, some dogs are very well trained and they'll just trot right next to you. But I've seen on a multiple occasions, people that are just, you could tell they're really struggling because that dog wants to sniff everything. It's pulling each direction. And I know there's listeners out there that are thinking, hey, that's my dog. And you have some ways you can help people with that.
Yeah, we're going to talk about on-leash training. So we're going to go through, how do I get my dog to be better on that leash? We're going to go through that training and we're going to say, you need to stay with it. You need to be patient and persevere. I think that is the word for on-leash training is persevere, but always be doing it. Now, if you've already like been through all that, we're going to actually talk about some tools that just put this on your dog and you don't even have to worry about it.
All right.
It's that easy.
I like that. That sounds just set it and forget it, like Ron Popeil, right? Just put it on and it works.
You come out with these names sometimes and I'm like, who are
you? You don't know Ron Popeil?
Wait, Popeil.
Ron Popeil. He was the guy who did he had the magic oven or something. It was an infomercial and it was his big slogan was set it and forget it. And it was a big TV thing.
Vaguely have
3 o'clock in the morning. You may have seen.
Yeah. Okay. That's why I don't know it. And then finally, we're going to talk about ultra dog food, a very complete nutrition for your dog. We're going to say, you know, pose the question, is this the right food for your dog?
I love it. Good deal. All right. So there we go. That is Ron Salisbury with Petland of Iowa City. We always do the amazing pet story of the week too. So we're going to do that right now. Big voice guy coming in.
Wow, he was a little intimidated.
He brought you a plant, a brand new flower for springtime.
Oh, that's
it's officially spring too. So
thank you,
big voice guy. I think he's
dead.
He gave what was that all about? Come on, big voice guy. At least get a. He got it from outside the gardener. They had it in the dumpster. He just told me. So that's all the thought process we get, I guess. Anyway, thanks, big voice guy. We always need you each week.
Yeah, I think he had good intentions.
Yeah, of course. Well, maybe. The dog, this story is about a dog that saved another dog from icy waters in Andalusia, Iowa. I do not know where Andalusia, Iowa is, but I'm going to figure that out because someone listening right now is probably from there or knows someone from there, and they are thinking, I know where that's at. I'm going to tell you where Andalusia, Iowa is. But this story is from January of last year, but worth bringing to the show this year because I think it's really cool. Matt Stark, who was on a boat in Andalusia, is the one who's quoted in this. A black Labrador had fallen through the ice and It was outside of a water treatment plant. Joe Dungan just returned from lunch. They saw the black dog running around. There was another black dog running around trying to get his attention to try and get that dog to help save the other dog. And they are able to do so. The dog saving another dog from icy waters. Quick thinking and fast feet saving the life of a dog that nearly drowned as it fell through the thin ice. So the barking got the attention, and they were able to pull the other dog out with the help of the other dog that helped pull him out, too. So they had a little extra use for the dog who helped pull another dog out of icy water. So very cool story from Andalusia, Iowa. And I will tell you where Andalusia is at right now. And as we do that, Ron's going to tell us about the bulldog here in just a minute. So you're going to want to stay tuned for that. We're going to take a break. And when we come back, we'll talk about the bulldog. We'll talk about the amazing pet story of... I'm going to time out. I just got distracted because somebody came in. All right, in 3, 2, 1. And we're going to talk about the ability to stop your dog from pulling you all over the place. If that's a problem for you, you're definitely going to want to stay tuned because we can help you out with that. Andalusia is near Davenport, apparently, right on the Mississippi there, right off the Mississippi. It's in between Muscatine and Davenport. So we're within the sound of Andalusia. There's people listening in Andalusia.
Yeah, right, they're going, so, hey, Jay.
Don't forget about us out there. So that's where that story came from. And since it's a small town, I bet everyone in town knows that story, too. And I probably screwed up some kind of detail of it. But it sounds like a fun story that a dog saved another dog from ice. It's a village in Rock County, Illinois. So it's just off the Illinois-Iowa border. We are going to get into our next update. We'll be right back with more after this on 800KXIC. As we go to break, Ron, tell us about your store.
We're Petland of Iowa City. There's a lot of things to do in our store. Everywhere from we're very tactile with our pets. We want you to hold them. We want you to learn about them. We're going to educate you about them. We're trying to find the right pet for the right family and meet the needs of both. That's our mission statement. Then other things that people come in, because they definitely come in for playing with pets. They also come in for our dog food, cat food, which is all on a buy 10, get one free. We track it for you. And it is all competitively priced because the manufacturer is who supports us with that program. And so we're able to do everything to get you the lowest cost possible and then have that buy 10, get one free program for you. In addition to that, $5 nail trims, you can't beat that. All we need is you to bring the latest vaccination schedule that you have. Bring the invoice or something. We'll copy it. We'll have it on record. $5 nail trims, no appointments necessary. We'll get it done for you. So take that stressor off you there. The rest of it, we have over 9,000 different products in our store. A ton of stuff. And so we love to work with you. If you have an issue that you're trying to resolve, ask us. If we're so honest, if one of our counselors doesn't know the answer, they're trained to go ask somebody that does know the answer. And so oftentimes I'll come out and talk with you and try to investigate, find out how can we solve that issue. We want you to have a great relationship with your pet and make it even stronger.
All right. That is Ron Salzer. That's Petland of Iowa City, Lower Muscatine. Check him out. We'll be right back with more after this. All right. Do that promo.
Oh, okay. Yeah. We're kind of primed for that right now.
Yeah. Ready to talk. See, it goes to 26th, right? 27th is the day. Okay. All right. In 3, 2, 1. 800KXIC morning host Jay Capron here with two bulldogs in studio, and Ron Salzrud's here. Ron, how are you?
English bulldogs. We're going to learn about the origins, fascinating origins of the English bulldog. Hint, they're not new to us. 1,600 years ago, we were working with English bulldogs. We're going to talk about on-leash training. Is your dog that one that pulls you around and yanks you around? We're going to talk about how to solve that issue. And then finally, talk about dog food. Ultra by Nutro. Is that the right food for your dog? It's a very complete nutrition.
That's Ron Salzer with Petland of Iowa City. Check out the Positively Petland Show Sunday mornings at 9 on 800-KXIC and KXIC.com. Welcome back. It's the Positively Petland Show, AM 800 KXIC, Iowa City. Apparently that's Andalusia, Illinois, right on the border of Iowa. So anyway, kind of a fun story, though. A dog helped save another dog's life falling to the ice just last year. Not too far away. It's within our listening area, right on the border there. Whether you're listening near the border of Iowa and Illinois or anywhere across eastern Iowa, thanks for hanging out with us. It's the Positively Petland Show. Ron Salzer here with Petland of Iowa City. I'm Jake Capron, and we're going to talk more about the bulldog now. We're also going to talk about how to train your dog, and it's really some tips for people that are really struggling to have that issue with their dog that pulls them when they're walking. Dogs naturally like to go and wander and see, sniff stuff, and they want to be in charge. There's a way that you can help out with that, so we'll talk about that, and we've got a food to feature as well a little bit later on. So, Ron, let's start with the bulldog. We've got two beautiful pups here in studio. They're not cheap, that's for sure. They're no, on the bulldogs, higher end of animals, of the puppies that you carry. And they're not for everyone, but they are certainly for some people, and they're the perfect dog for some people. So tell us about the English Bulldog.
So the English Bulldog, let's stump Jay, right? Let's try to do a couple of questions today.
England.
Yeah, all right. England, the island of England, is where they come from. Putting in a little bit of history, the Romans and Europeans were invading and crossing England over the years, and the mastiffs that they brought to England were all crossbred. So this is, they don't have a this and that kind of a thing. This is multiple things going on, mastiffs coming together, creating the English Bulldog. Now, I don't know why I didn't even ponder this thing, but why do you think they call it a bulldog? And that's a good stumping question. Yeah, you came up with the answer.
What I said is I thought maybe they helped to round up bull or cattle or something. I don't know.
They were known to guard bulls, control bulls, and finally bait bulls. I was like, what?
Whoa.
I'm not quite sure I understand what baiting bulls means. Are they trying to round up bulls?
Yeah, I think that
they use a bulldog.
Yeah, you're trying to get them to come at them, to get them to go to certain areas. So you'd use the dog as bait, and the bull would run at the dog, and then you could get them into the pen.
Must have been something like that. Well, the good news is, as humans, we figured out that might not be the right way to do it.
Yeah.
Because back in 1835, it became illegal to do that. So interesting kind of past on these little guys. Makes you love them even more. You're like, oh, you little buddy, you've had a tough start. So that's the history of them. Here's another question. How many colleges do you think bulldogs as their mascots?
There's gotta be. All right, there's Butler, there's Georgia.
Oh wait, you're going
I know,
low. You're
I
going
know.
Way later.
No, I'm just saying, I know there's a lot. Colleges and or universities, you said?
College and universities.
103.
Oh, more than 40. So I thought you were gonna go low on me on there. Yeah so more than 40. I know Drake.
Yeah.
And that's what I'll
learn. No, there's got to be, especially the community colleges and small ones across the country. They're a popular one. And then they bring them onto the field, and they're always a big hit, too, when they're wearing the little sweaters.
Yeah. They're cuter and cute. So here I wanted to read Form and Function from the AKC book. Bulldogs are massive, low-slung dogs with heavy boned legs, broad chests, and short tails. Their large heads have a flattened muzzle, upturned lower jaw, and a wide-set eyes that convey a sense of dignity. I love that. That was so cool. So the English Bulldog in general, this is one of the laziest dogs out there. They do have that puppy energy for a little bit, you know, kind of a thing. The best quote I've heard from a bulldog owner is, take a bulldog for a walk and it's done with its exercise for the day. Run that block and it's done for the week. It's just not a active dog. So that's one aspect of an English bulldog that you'll want to know about. Is that the right breed for you? Second thing is it is higher maintenance. It's a big dog. It eats a massive amount of stuff. And it's a little dirty in how it operates. You know, the kibble's going all over the place and all that kind of stuff. So you're not getting the bulldog to be dainty with it. The bulldog is a dog, you know, kind of a thing. And so those are the two characteristics that you need. One of them that Jay and I were talking about is oh, I heard they have a lot of health problems. And the statistics point out that 5% of all dogs are going to have a pretty major, you know, a major health issue. Bulldogs are twice that. So 10% of the bulldogs have a major issue. So I wouldn't shy away from the bulldog just because of a health reason, but they are expensive on the front end. Surgeries are going to be then more expensive. So you're going to, you know, that would be more of an expense to take on. So be cautious if that's an issue for you. Yeah, there probably is a better breed for you to take on. And then let's see, what else can we talk about the bulldog? The health issues, yeah, we talked about 5%, 10%. There is some maintenance that you're going to do. They have rolls and stuff on the fur and skin, and that you got to clean those things out and all that kind of stuff. It's kind of like having a grandparent that you really have to take care of. You know? So it is a wonderful dog, though. So I don't want to downplay it too much here, because, and I don't think I can. I think everybody out there is going, they're better than that. And you're right. They are. They're a wonderful dog. America loves the English Bulldog. And you'll get a lot of satisfaction. If you love this breed, all of that stuff is going to be moot for you. You're going to take it all in and say, it is what it is, and I love my dog. Just like we all do.
It's also telling, that's part of, I know, what you do at your store is to educate people, let them know about some of the issues, so it's not a huge surprise. And then they come back a year later and say, hey, you know, I had no idea it was going to do this or that. It's all part of the educational process.
Right. So. I just was overhearing some of my counselors talk with people about puppies yesterday, and there was a Siberian Husky that was out with a customer, and the customer said something about, I'm looking for a mellow dog. And the counselor kind of like went, well, okay, well, yeah, how am I going to break this one to you? The Husky's not a mellow dog. And so we do talk with you through, give you the facts. We get books out for you. We say, this is what this breed is all about, so that you have an educated decision-making process that you can go through.
That's something I don't think I've ever talked to you about. And we've been doing this show for 5 years now, is books. Do you have books at your store with each of the breeds?
Yeah, we have breed books, specific breed books. We also, for small animals, you know, little hamsters and
ferrets. That's helpful.
We have birds, we have fish, we have little books on those. And then we get other material out that are fairly easy to summarize while we're working with you.
It's good. It's good to be educated like that too, because I know there's simple things. I remember reading that, I think it was gerbils or hamsters or something, aren't supposed to eat pickles because they could die.
Oh, there's
these little things like that.
Yeah,
and you wouldn't think, you know, you feed hamsters or other little animals sometimes people food, or you know, you think, oh, it's not going to hurt, but little stuff like that you got to know. So
right, iceberg lettuce for small animals tends to be not the greatest thing. It gives them the runs because it's so high in water.
Right.
And so they go, if you're going to do a leafy vegetable, do a dark green leafy vegetable kind of a thing.
And those are little tips you can learn from the books.
Yes. Cool.
All right, so that's the bulldog. We wanted to talk about that. There's a couple of them here in studio, and probably maybe still at the pet store if you want to check out the Petland of Iowa City, Lower Muscatine in Iowa City. And Ron's going to talk today about specifically about when dogs are tugging you around, there's ways that you can help, and it's not just a choke chain, that type of thing. There's you have some other issues, you have some ways to help out people, and not just, I told you this story before. I had a golden, a yellow lab growing up. I was a little boy at the time, and he was a strong dog, and he used to pull me, and so he was unpleasant walking down. He was going, he was trying to, you know, because it was one of those collars that would get tighter, and he was unpleasant. I was unpleasant because he's pulling me, and it wasn't working. That was our formula. So then we ended up getting a situation where we could just let him run out in the yard, and it was much more comfortable. But when we took him on walks, neither one of us was having a fun time.
Right. And we're not going to talk about the choker collar type things. And there's even milder, like the martingale. I said, you know, those tools are more demonstrated or learned one-on-one. or in a class, if you go take a class. If you have that extreme situation where here we're going to talk about solutions on the air here, and you go, after all of this, I've got that massive dog that can pull a car, and I'm still having problems with him. That's when you do go to a trainer and say, hey, how can I help with that? We can do some of that training in the store as well and show you how to do that. Because whenever I see somebody buying the choker collar and stuff like that, I always go, okay, have you ever used one before? Tell me how. I want to learn from you. How are you using it? Now I can go into a little bit of education to say, in order for this type of product to work, you got to do it this way. What you just described, you know, doing that clearly was telling me that you weren't using it right. You just didn't know.
Yep.
And so we could tell you how to do that. Trainers do a great job here in town as well. I love how you started also, though, with let them run around. I think a lot of us, when we're walking our dogs and they're, you know, you're having issues and all that kind of stuff, if we only just let them run around in the backyard, in the fenced yard, throw the ball around, get some of the energy out, realize dogs run a lot faster than we do. So if we think we can run with our dog and wear the dog out, if it's a big dog or a medium to big dog, that ain't going to happen. Preload this dog with a little bit of exercise and run them out and all that kind of stuff, so that when you go for a run, it's more of a cool down for those larger dogs, and getting some of that energy out. I think that is step number one. If you have issues with a pulling dog, get some of that energy out before you even start walking. Then when you get out there, the next step is to train your dog as far as, how do I incentivize my dog to walk next to me as opposed to pulling, or as opposed to wandering back and forth, or even worse, lassoing my legs, you know, going around and around and all that, and you're having issues with that. I love the collar or the leads that are out there now. Jay, look at this one that I have on here. This is a fashion statement. Yeah. You're making a statement with this thing.
It's pink and purple with swirls all over it.
Right. It's very girly. Yeah. But you know what? I think it is like kind of cool looking, because, oh, there is purple in it. And I'm a big, huge purple fan. And so I'd even use this thing. But get a lead. You've got 4 foot leads and 6 foot leads out there that are great for walking your dog. Now, this is only the start, because you know how we're using these 6 foot leads, we're using those retractable leads and all that. Realize when we're using these longer leads, we're teaching our dog that they can, you know, run out, they can go further, they can go off to the side, because they've got that liberty to do that. And if you're saying, well, I don't like that when they do that, then you need to change your behavior, and that is not get these long leads, especially those retractable leads. People get the retractable leads thinking they're going to solve the pull issue. Everybody that's got that retractable lead, what happens when you get it? They pull it all the way, and they want more. They want to go further. And that's why those retractable leads tend to fail prematurely, is because we allow them to go all the way out to the end and then tug, 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 and then it breaks the little mechanisms on the inside of it. So those that have ruined a couple of those retractable leads, you've been getting clues that you haven't, you've gone down the right path. And that's what we want to go through today. So I'm throwing that longer lead into the bin right now. Okay. For you out there that have these issues, I am now holding, let's see, what is it saying? An 18 inch. And then I have even a shorter one. I think it's 9 inch lead. This one is so short that when you're holding it, it just is a lead, but it's a very short lead. Your dog has to stay by you because it doesn't have any length to go any further. That's what you want. You got to start here in order to train your dog to stay by you. You can't give them that liberty to go further. Now that you have this lead and it's a shorter lead and your dog is there, you're going, Ron, this thing is still going crazy. I mean, it's just going crazy by my side now. It's even bumping me now. This is even worse. Okay, so now the training comes in. We know how to incentivize dogs over the years that we've been on the air, and what you probably learned on TV and stuff like that. You incentivize, tell the dog, communicate to the dog, you like what they're doing. How? by giving them a treat, by food. Giving them praise. Mm-hmm. But the food scientifically has been proven that it is a huge incentivizer for dogs. And so it's one of the most powerful training tools that you have. We've talked about the lickety stick. You don't have to give them a meal. You just have to give them a taste. And so while you're walking along, if your dog is going crazy, the first thing to do is stop. Don't go any further. This dog wants to go on that walk, but if they're not behaving, then you have to stop and get them to calm down. And be prepared for a short walk, because if you can't get this thing figured out, then you got to go back home, maybe even go back into the backyard and get more of this energy out of your dog and really understand the dynamics and energy level of your dog. When is it calmed down? So now you're stopped in the sidewalk. So let's say that your dog does actually calm down here and you don't have to go back home. You then stop and you work on them with the sit or something like that to get them to calm down. Now that they're calmed down, give them the treat, give them the incentivize, communicate to them that they're doing the right thing right now, that they're calm. So you give them a treat. So now you might pause for a little bit. Everything's good. All right, let's start moving forward again. Oh, hey, they didn't spaz out right away. Give them another treat. A lot of treats, especially at the beginning. And you want to even couple it with some kind of a phrase that you want to associate with, you know, good dog, or whatever it is. I always like to I love it when people come up with crazy sayings that they do that just make sense, but are just a little funny. Come up with something like that. So good dog treat, good dog treat. When they are calm, oh, it got crazy again because it saw a dog across the street. Now you're going to stop and sit again. Wait, that dog across the street's getting closer and closer, or maybe we're just close enough where our dog is responding. So what you have to do in that situation is turn around and get away from the situation. So whether it's a dog, a squirrel, birds, whatever it is that your dog just will not calm down mm-hmm. with, get away from it. So now you're removing that obstacle. That's for another day as far as conditioning your dog to not go crazy when another dog is around. Right now, we're only working on how can I get my dog to be calm while I'm walking? Remove that obstacle out of your way at this point. Turn around, go walk in another direction away from it. What you're going to do in that situation long term, once you've got the walking figured out, is there's a distance that your dog will start going crazy at when another dog approaches. Mm-hmm. And you're going to, and the best thing to do is when there's a dog behind a fence, that dog can't get any closer to you no matter what. So now you can work with that, with your dog, with that dog. Yeah. And you can get a little closer, incentivize when they are calm, when your dog is calm. And now get a little closer, incentivize when your dog is calm. Oh, your dog just went a little crazy. Turn back, walk away for a little bit. Get to where your dog is calm again, incentivize because he's calm again and all that. So you get what I'm talking about? Incentivize when your dog is calm by giving them a treat. Good dog, good dog. And then when they are going and doing the wrong behavior that you don't want them to do, either stop and get them calmed down or remove yourself from that situation, whatever it is. But then make sure you incentivize immediately when they calm back down again. So again, they know when I'm calm, I get this treat. Can you imagine what they're telling the other dogs as they're passing them? You know, hey, calm down. You're gonna get a lot. Yeah, you're gonna get a lot of treats, man. I think I've got a belly full right now. You know, you're communicating well with them. They get it then. So that's the general approach to on-leash training overall. There's a lot of little tips and tricks and all that kind of stuff, but in general, that is it. And what you want to do is persevere. That's the biggest thing in this situation is no dog is going to be perfect on the first walk or the fifth walk or the 10th or the 20th walk. Maybe even after the 100th walk, they're pretty good, man. But all of a sudden, they spaz out because they see something. All right, just calm down. We're not back to step one at this point. We just now have something that an obstacle that we have to overcome as far as training goes and work with them on that individual basis then. So some other really cool tools out there. So maybe you have two dogs. realized there are a thing called couplers, or I call them splitters. You know, if you are walking two dogs, do you have two leads? And now you got two leads that go out. Let's say they're just 6 foot, and your dogs are just going back and forth, back and forth, back and forth, and their leads are all tangled up. Get one of these splitters, because what you're going to do is reduce down to one lead. You're going to have that in your hand. It's going to couple to the splitter, and it's going to split down closer to your dog, down into two leads. And you can even lengthen the splitter so that they have some more room and all that kind of stuff, you know, depending on the characteristics of your dog.
Interesting.
But the splitter is a wonderful tool, underutilized. I see it so often where people are at the corner and they're cussing and swearing because the dogs are jumping all over the place and they're getting tangled. Mm-hmm. They're tangling the owner up and all that kind of stuff. Just get one of these splitters and you resolve most of the problems right there. So they can spin around on each other and all that kind of stuff, and this coupler will not care a bit. It will let them go and there won't be any tangles and all that. So we talked about, you know, the lead. Don't get those long leads thinking you're going to solve your pulling problems. We talked about these smaller, shorter leads, 18 inches and shorter, so that they don't have that long thing to utilize and learn how to pull on them. Now, let's say you're that customer that says, I don't have time for this training. Or let's say you're the customer that says, I tried it and I can't figure it out, and I don't have time to go to a trainer, like you said, because I got a guy that can pull a car. Know that there are wonderful no-pull collars out there. I want to step back one bit. If you have a pulling problem, a harness is not your solution. A harness is that one where, well, my dog, when he pulls, he's like strangling himself and stuff, so I'm going to get him a harness so it's easier on the dog. You just made the pulling problem a lot worse, because now it's got its shoulders to lean into, and it's distributing that weight amongst the body and all that kind of stuff. So the dog's going to pull even harder. Realize a harness, hey, don't they use harnesses on sled dogs and all that kind of stuff? That's to make it more convenient for the dog to pull. So don't make it convenient for your dog to pull on you. So now these no-pull harnesses are designed to stop the dog from wanting to pull on you. There's one that leads from the nose. So when you put the collar around the neck, it connects to another little apparatus that goes loops right around the nose of your dog. And then that's where you put your lead onto. Now, picture when you just gently pull on that lead, what happens to the head? The head comes back to you. A dog will go where the head is pointed. And so that's why they've used this approach. So if you gently just pull back, the dog is going to then, head's going to turn, and it's going to be looking at you, and it was pulling, but now it's coming right back to you. And so it is one of those really nice devices that works really well. Some people don't like that thing that goes around their nose, and they go, yeah, my dog really, you know, messes with it a lot and all that. It's usually just a temporary issue. I always say try it on in the house for 2 minutes and then take it off. Let your dog know this is temporary, this isn't permanent. And walk around the house then. Get them used to it. Your dog will get used to that little loop around their nose area, their jaw and nose area. And the will get used to it walking on walks with you and all that kind of stuff, and won't be, you know, infatuated with that thing around their nose.
Probably more excited it's going on a walk.
You're right. At that point, it's like, I already get this. Yeah. We're on a walk.
Yeah.
And so that is one kind of training collar. The one that I just love is called the Sporn Halter. This one works in a different way in that it has a collar around the neck. It looks like a harness that goes around the shoulders and underneath the arms and all that kind of stuff. But when you pull on the lead, it actually pulls on the lower section of that collar. It loops around underneath there. This thing's got padding on it, all sorts of fleece. It's really kind to the dog, easy for the dog. When you pull on it, it naturally slows your dog down, way down. I love it because when customers come into our store and go, you know, or we just see him, the dog's just going, oh, you know, it's like a bunkin' bronco in our store. I go, hey, can I show you what the Sporn collar is? We put it on, and I go, walk around the store for as long as you want. with this collar on. I want you to see the effect that you're going to get on it. 100% of the time, they come to the register and say, I have to buy this. This is an amazing product. It's that great of a product. The Sporn Halter is a wonderful product for those of you out there that have just, I have totally given up on this whole walking thing because my dog yank, yank, yanks. I've tried the training. I've given up on it. Go get the Sporn Halter. Now, I will say it does not train your dog to not pull. It just stops them from pulling when you're walking. So it only works when it's on. You can't switch to something else and find out that your dog still, you'll find out your dog still pulls. Maybe when it's 15 years old, it'll start slowing down, kind of a thing. So that's the Sporn Halter. Another quick tip on, you know, we're talking about the Sporn Halter. I talked right before that about a harness. Realize these are walking tools. One does the opposite of the other. But when you're done with them, you have to take them off or you're going to be back in and buying another one from us. The dog will chew these off. So you can't leave a harness on a dog if you're not walking them, because they will just reach around and they just will find it interesting to nibble on it and then they chew it right off. So make sure you take these things off when they're all done. The only thing you can really keep on a dog is the collar itself. And that's something that, you know, even then you're cautious when you're putting them in a kennel and stuff. So that is walking your dog. Nice. I'm a walking your dog.
Walking your dog. And we're just about out of time, but we did leave a little time to talk about some food. So you always like to feature food at the end of the show. Tell us about it, Ron.
So we're going to talk about ultra dog food. Just flip into Dog Food Advisor first. We like to use a third party type way of looking at these things. Dog Food Advisor rates Nutro Ultra Dry as 4 out of 5. That's a very good rating. 4 out of 5 is next to perfect. And here, what they're going to point out as why they knocked it down to a 4, I would disagree with. And I think they, if you read their literature, they actually disagree with it too. What they do is some people are sensitive about some ingredients. I think they're misinformed, and you can read the between the lines on Dog Food Advisor, and they will also say that people are misinformed. In this case, dried plain beet pulp, that ingredient is used as fiber in the dog's diet. I will tell you that 90% of dog foods have this in there, and we love it because it makes the poop like Tootsie Rolls instead of mushy like soft serve. So dried beet pulp has a very good purpose to it. You can get that fiber from other sources, but beet pulp is fairly cheap because we love sugar. And if you're eating sugar and we all do, chances are it's beet sugar from the upper Midwest, all the beet farms. One of the byproducts is beet pulp. And they have found that beet pulp is still, even to us, would be good as a fiber product. We have chosen to put it in dog food. But there are some people that say, oh, beet pulp, that's from sugar. You don't feed sugar to your... Well, mm-hmm. The sugar is gone. Trust me. They don't want to put sugar in there. They want to give it to us. They get more money for that sugar. So that's where the misnomer is. So enough with that. 4 out of 5, that's an awesome review from
I think there's only been 1 5 out of 5, and that was the one that's like $80 a bag.
Yeah, that's when you got to pay up. So real quickly, ultra dog food, some of the benefits. You're going to see radiant, healthy skin and coats because of all the omega-3s, fatty acids, flaxseed, sunflower oil, all sorts of stuff that they put in there at a high level to get the skin and coat as radiant as possible, but also less shedding you're going to see. Strong muscles because of the proteins that they've put in there and the complementary amino acids, the strong muscles that you're going to get out of there. The immunity that you're going to get off of it because of the antioxidants and the probiotics and all that are working really strong in here to have that immunity system built up. Heart healthy because of the fish, salmon that is in there, the rolled oats, vine ripened tomatoes, all sorts of things that will make for a healthier heart for your dog. So circulatory system is the number one thing you got to pay attention to, both us and your dogs. Sharp vision because of of the products that they put in there for that. So it's a really good overall product. On their puppy formula, if you wanted to start off your puppy on this, they're going to have the DHAs in there to make for a better brain development. This is known for people. We've known this for a long time. It actually has been in the dog food industry for about 5 years, and they've already done scientific studies saying the dog is actually smarter when they get the DHA during the brain development years. So if we've got that older dog, it's not going to work for them, and it won't work for us either because we're too old for it as well. So that is Ultra. Really great, very complete nutrition. A lot of three different protein sources, three different oats and all that kind of stuff. So they go through a lot of variety within the food to keep your dog really, really healthy.
All right. That's Ron Salzer with Petland of Iowa City, and we are out of time. This has been the Positive Petland Show, the English Bulldog in focus today, a dog that saved another dog from falling through the ice. Plus, we learned how to walk your dog a little bit more comfortably, and you just heard about that great new dog food called what?
Ultra.
Ultra.
Check by Nutro.
By Nutro. And we'll be right back with more after this. Ron, until next week, bye.
Thank you very much.
Check out the Positively Petland Show Sunday mornings at 9 and at KXIC.com on the podcast page. And check out Petland of Iowa City on Lower Muscatine. They open up at noon today if you're listening on Sunday. Bye.